Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you've had a thoughtful, enjoyable morning and wonderful lunch here. I'm looking forward to coming back tomorrow after having that lunch. We're here tomorrow too, so that's another lunch. Thank you so much for coming back after lunch. And we're excited to introduce our panel to you this afternoon for a conversation. When the panel are sharing their thoughts, please would you think up some questions for them as they're sharing their own reflections. And, you know, the floor will be open to questions then. I think we're going to start with our panel introducing themselves. And if you wouldn't mind sharing who you are, something about your work right now and the priorities and commitments you have heading into the new year and the new curriculum. Shall we start with Simon?
Okay. Diolch yn fawr. So I'm Simon Perrott, the newly appointed CEO of the Commission for Tertiary Education and Research. Delighted to be here today. I'll assume you know very little around the Commission, so please forgive me if I'm telling you things that you already know. But the Commission for Tertiary Education and Research will come into being in April 2024. And the legislation is there to bring together, really, all aspects of post-16 education. So the Commission will have oversight and will fund all post-16 education. That will include universities, colleges, school sixth forms, apprenticeships, and adult learning providers as well. And also the R of the Commission is research as well. So we'll have some oversight of research in our predominantly in our universities across Wales. People keep reminding me that it is the second biggest budget outside of health. I think they're trying to frighten me. There's obviously, and you heard from the Minister this morning, there's a huge burden of responsibility, I suppose, in terms of having that oversight. The Higher Education Funding Council for Wales, that at the moment is the regulator for our HE institutions in Wales, will dissolve on the 31st of March. So the staff from HEFQ will be moving into the Commission, as will some members of staff from Welsh Government as well, have responsibility for some of the post-16 provision as well. And there will be some new appointments as well. One of the things that we've heard a lot this morning around the challenges around funding, and one of the things that I'm saying to all elements and all aspects of the post-16 sector is that there are two tracks, I suppose, for the Commission as far as I'm concerned. One is to try and have a smoother landing as we possibly can in April. It would be wonderful to be launching the Commission next year with a whole shed load of cash, wouldn't it? And saying, here we are, we've got more slight funding. But as we all know, that isn't going to be the case, and funding is going to be really challenging. We'll be inheriting some of those funding decisions from Welsh Government, and in the future, the money we will get from Welsh Government, there'll be more and more responsibility in the Commission to decide, I suppose, how that money is spent. But the other track, so one is around like trying to give as much stability as we possibly can in turbulent and challenging funding times. But the second track, I suppose, and it was interesting sitting in on some of the workshops today, is not to miss the opportunity to have some of those ambitious conversations. I think in Wales we have a great opportunity here as well, in that we're a small, agile nation. And when I talk to colleagues that work in other countries across the world, there is a lot of interest in what's happening in Wales. There aren't that many nations that are bringing together all those aspects of post-16 education. I think probably the one that comes to mind is New Zealand, and lots of similarities, I suppose, between Wales and New Zealand in terms of geographical challenges, the cultural work that's happening in New Zealand, and also the size of the population, a little bit bigger than Wales, about 4.5 million, I think. So lots of learning for us. But one of the things that strikes me as well, and maybe, you know, one of the things that we were talking about in one of the sessions earlier around leadership, I suppose we have two choices when funding gets hard. One is we can batten down the hatches and become more competitive and aggressive because it's getting challenging. Or we take another approach, which is about reaching out and collaborating more and thinking about how we can work together to solve some of the knotty problems that we have. And we're not alone in this in Wales. We see these problems across the world in terms of some of the challenges. So that's kind of my mantra, I suppose, really, is in terms of thinking about how we can have some of those conversations. And it was interesting over coffee earlier, just starting some of those conversations with individuals talking about their particular regions and what those conversations could look like in the future. So although it's challenging and there's a lot to do between now and April and beyond, I'm really excited actually about the opportunities that we have to give even greater opportunities for the learners that we serve across Wales.
We're doing some work actually in Darfol and in some of the schools that are here today in New Zealand, and it's been really inspiring to have conversations and all the learning that comes with their understanding of bilingualism, the sense of belonging, a very holistic approach to the curriculum. So we're learning a lot in those conversations and exchanges. So I'd love to talk with you more about that. Thank you so much. We'll go on to our next panellist to introduce yourself and your work and your commitments and priorities for next year or the coming year.
Thank you very much. Pranam Da.
Good afternoon, I'm Emer George, and I'm here on behalf of Qualifications Wales this afternoon, where I have been for many years now, leading on our programme of qualification reform for the future, and through that leading on reforming qualifications for 14 to 16 year old learners.
In terms of our qualifications reform programme, Qualified for the Future, focused on 14 to 16 learning, our priorities for the year ahead, I guess they fall into sort of two separate tracks running to slightly different time frames. We are working very closely with colleagues in Welsh Government and with WJC on the reform and the introduction of a brand new Made for Wales suite of GCSEs, which hopefully many of you will be aware that WJC have just recently closed a mini consultation on the outline with more detail of what those new qualifications will look like. So we're very much focusing on ensuring that together and with others, we are focused on helping schools and centres to prepare for those changes, being clear about what will be available in terms of resources, professional learning, a package of support to help make sure that those qualifications are introduced successfully and in line with very much the curriculum for Wales. And we've talked about some of that in different sessions this morning. So that's the GCSE work. And then in January now, very soon, we'll be announcing our decisions following our consultation earlier this year on the full 14 to 16 qualifications offer. So all those other qualifications that will be available alongside those new GCSEs. And we'll be setting our direction of travel then in our announcements end of January, and looking to work once again closely right across the sector on developing the detail of what those new qualifications will need to look like when they are introduced in for first teaching from September 2027. So we're very much still on that reform journey, very much still on that collaborative co-construction journey. And it's great to be here on the panel with you, Chantel, because I know we've been working more increasingly closely over recent months, particularly, for example, on looking at how in these new qualifications we really are doing everything we can to embed what's there in the curriculum and that it comes through in the qualifications and the courses of learning that our young people will be experiencing when they get to that point in a few short years.
I think it's been remarkable actually to do the Darpling with yourselves and in collaboration with WJC, and there are some stands here today. So if you haven't had conversations or you don't get chance to have and share your views in questions today, please go up and have a chat with the teams, because there is some really deep professional learning happening across the board, and it's been a troubling and challenging in a very valuable way journey.
Do you mind if I'm a bit cheeky and just say, so personally, in terms of my priorities for the year ahead, they might be a little different to those of Qualifications Wales. So I'll be starting in January on a new chapter, heading up as the first chief exec of a new small body called ADNOV, which will be tasked with securing, coordinating, commissioning and quality assuring educational resources to support the rollout of the new curriculum for Wales. So bilingual, high quality resources. So you'll no doubt still be hearing from me, but in a different capacity. So I just thought I'd take this opportunity. Not everybody's heard of it. It's a new organisation. It exists on paper, but not yet in terms of a staff, called ADNOV. So my focus next year will be on putting a team together for that and looking to make the right connections so that we can get off to the best possible start.
Fantastic. We look forward to Darfling there too. And sure. Helen, If you would mind sharing some reflections of your work and some commitments and priorities as you go forward. We share a history. We're both alumni of Mrs. Betty Campbell. So I was taken by the hand to school by Mrs. Campbell from next door but one as a child. And I've got some lovely photos of her and me recently when I was 7 in the classroom. And she taught me a lot about thinking differently. But Helen's also one of her alumni. She was working with Mrs. Campbell as a student teacher and an early career teacher. But anyway, that's how we've met in previous work. Helen, yeah, if you wouldn't mind sharing some thoughts on your commitments and priorities and your work generally.
Good afternoon to you all. I'm Helen Morgan, Regis Morgan. I'm director of Swansea Council. I'm not necessarily here to represent the opinions of all directors across Wales, but I would imagine that the priorities are quite similar. In terms of Swansea, the priorities are simple and very clear in our relationship with schools. First of all, looking at absence or attendance and ensuring that we mitigate the risks in the medium term and the long term, and how this impacts on society, but also ensuring that we do so in ways, in innovative ways, progressive ways with the schools to ensure that the solutions we have for attendance are new, that are suitable for meeting the problems, the new problems that we have in terms of attendance. So that is a clear priority for us, first of all. The second thing is to ensure that there is improvement in how we manage behaviour in schools, either ensuring provision across the county to ensure that there are appropriate places, but also ensuring inclusion and ensuring that the pupils we have, that we meet their needs, that we understand what the problems are that they have, and that we understand what their story is, to ensure that we address their needs. Thirdly, I would say that the curriculum is a strong priority for us in Swansea, to ensure that we look to the future in terms of employers and ensure there's a clear focus on digital work. That's something we would take pride in Swansea. But also, as I said about behaviour, that we conduct a strategy and implement a strategy across the schools related to inclusion, anti-racial work as well. We've done a lot of work with DARPL. But to ensure that schools meet the needs of all pupils and achieve excellence in doing so. And also in terms of the curriculum, to ensure that coming out of the pandemic that we do focus on the most important things. The Minister mentioned this morning about literacy and numeracy. We have to get those core things in place to ensure that there is a suitable curriculum as well. So those fundamentals are important to us in Swansea. And on top of that, there are statutory responsibilities in all local authorities. And of course, with the discussions relating to funding recently, we realise that there is quite an interesting discussion about what is statutory, what isn't statutory, what do we need to do, and how we can adapt for the future. And of course, legislation may have to change in future to be contemporary. But also, we ensure in Swansea that we look at the workforce, look at the needs of the workforce, not just in terms of well-being, but also to ensure that we have leaders in the future, a pipeline of leader, broad-minded, fresh leaders in Swansea, something that's very important to us. We are also looking at the Welsh language, as are all other local authorities, at a very strategic level to ensure that there is a provision, not just in terms of places, but in terms of people, and to ensure that there is a supply, a workforce supply, to ensure that there is a future for the language in the schools and beyond. So those are the priorities. In order to address some of those challenges, I would say, very similar to Simon, that there are clear opportunities that we have to ensure that we have fresh ways of solving the problems that we have. So I would encourage people to pause, not to push on too much, but to pause. Following something like a pandemic or the new economic crisis, there's an opportunity for us to pause and to think differently. So that's something I would try to encourage in others. Also, there's an opportunity to collaborate. We maybe sometimes don't think about sharing bad practice, but I think when we are struggling, sharing with others is key. So we are very familiar with sharing effective practice, but there's possibly an opportunity as well to talk about some of those things that are worrying us increasingly. So that's a golden opportunity, but also an opportunity to listen to pupils more. I think that's something across the UK that we have to ensure that we do. Not just in Wales, but it's true in all societies that we have to listen more following the pandemic. And finally, I would say, as resources start to diminish, there is an opportunity for us, a golden opportunity to consider what is most important and how we prioritise. So we have to, some of those responsibilities and roles have to shrink just as resources are shrinking, so that these discussions are ongoing during the year, and hopefully by the end of the financial year we will have come up with some kind of balance to the funding.
Thank you so much. It's a privilege in our organisation in DARPL. We are working with people across Wales in lots of roles, and the regional, getting to see what's happening across regions is really inspiring, and within your team in particular, we've been doing some really deep work. Thank you so much. And then last but not least, our last panellist, over to you.
Thank you, Owen Evans, P. Vera Lugia.
I'm the Chief Inspector at Estyn.
I think we're on a journey. We've been changing our ethos for a number of years now, particularly since it's 5 years since Graham Donaldson wrote the Learning Inspectorate. So in changing that ethos, we've focused really on building the trust between Estyn and practitioners, in actually making sure that what we do actually adds value to schools, but also in tweaking that relationship that I think all inspectorates have between assurance and actually helping people improve. And I think we're changing the balance in how we do that, and hopefully people will see that we're doing it. You know, we've built on the engagement visits that we had during the pandemic. I think that did us a power of good. We've got rid of summative judgments. The nominee model, I think, is well established now, and our use of peer inspectors, I think, is hugely valuable to us. But we're never happy. We're always looking at what happens in the future. So I'm out and about. I visit a school every fortnight, at least. And I always have a cup of tea with the head. And what I'm trying to do is really gauge how is the system coping, how are people actually reflecting on what we do. So if I come and see you, it is random, I promise. big things for the coming years, finish the cycle. I do believe in a cycle, and we must finish it over the next 12 months. But really to have an eye on what we do for the next cycle, which commences in September next year. We have a very active head teachers reference group, which I attend every one. We also have a post-16 reference group. And we've been trying out new ideas about, first of all, how we focus on what matters, and I saw the workshop on what matters, that we actually try and destigmatize and depressure the main inspection, and that we actually come and see you more often. So it's more of a developing relationship. But people are involved, you are involved as a sector in how we're developing that, and I think that's vitally important. One of the other things I think that we have to do, we can get better on, is about identifying best practice. We're developing a lot of case study material now that we haven't been particularly great about how to get it out to you and make it useful. So it's partly getting that information out to you, partly making it more accessible. And I think, you know, summarising and putting it into words and language that people can assimilate very quickly and adapt into practice. So I think for me, those are the priorities for the coming year.
What's been really interesting is that is seeing from another angle the deep and hurried professional learning and the emphasis on improving and learning in the team as well. It's been really fascinating and fantastic to be part of that. So thank you so much. I think we're going to go to questions now. We have some already prepared and that's been sent in. Shall we go to the floor, or do you want to start?
I think so, yes. I have some, and somebody mentioned earlier on, I think they must have sent in a question that I hadn't asked it this morning, so I'm going to make sure that, I can't see that head teacher here now, that we go through them all if we can, and they are for individual members of the panel, but I would encourage you particularly, given that this is Emyr's probably last outing in his role for Qualifications for Wales, it might be a good time to ask him the questions that are pressing on your minds. And obviously, first questions, I suppose, for Simon in a forum like this. Are there any questions from the floor that we want to start with? Is that Hugo? And we've got Edward over here as well.
I'm going for the hat trick of questions. So it's a really broad one. Actually, this isn't directed towards anyone in particular. I'm interested in your view of how school-led the education system should be. How much of it is leadership from school practitioners?
That's a really interesting one. I think I'll take that to the entire panel. But can we have Edwards first, then we can do two at once.
So budgets are going to be very tight. We'll probably get them very late. And obviously our post-16 allocation is really important in terms of schools. So I'm just wondering how the new commission will be, you know, will you be up and running and ready? And will we expect any major changes in our post-16 funding for the next financial year?
Right, I think that's an obvious one for Simon. If we could start with that one before we go into the school-led system and how school-led should it be? Simon?
So the Welsh Government budget hasn't sort of been finalised and signed off yet. As far as the Commission is concerned, we'll be inheriting whatever budget decisions are made by Welsh Government for the coming year. Following that, obviously the money will still be coming from Welsh Government, but I think there'll be more and more responsibility given to the Commission about how that money is actually spent. You heard from the Minister this morning in terms of trying to do as much as he can at Cabinet level to protect our budgets. But we're not seeing sort of going into next academic year things that are going to be significantly different as far as the Commission is concerned, but I can't speak for where what the money is going to be dictating and where that money is coming from. If I could touch, because connected with that, I think if you don't mind, is the question around leadership, because I think there's something there as well in terms of funding, and I touched on it earlier, and I think it's a really good question around sort of leadership, and obviously government has its role, minister has its role, I have my role in terms of being the CEO of the Commission. But I think I was once in a room a few years ago with a leader of an institution was saying to a Welsh Government civil servant, you just tell us what to do and we'll do it. And I remember thinking at that time that maybe there was a lack of leadership there, because if all, and I've been a leader of an institution as well, and if it's all about, so like, you tell us what to do and we'll do and we implement, then we're missing a trick there. It's evident today, the passion for education, you know, people who move into education and go into the field that we're working in do so because of a vocational calling, isn't it? And I think sort of as far as the Commission is concerned, we're certainly open to suggestions and to ways of working. You touched there, Chantal, about looking at other parts of the world as well. And it's interesting, in different regions across Wales, there are different ideas and things coming forward, and some excellent examples of partnership working and solutions-focused leadership that's going on there. So I think in my answer to the question would be it's a bit of both. It's a bit about sort of like strategy and leadership coming from government and from other sort of like bodies, but also the leadership as well at a local level I think is really, really important.
Thank you, Simon. And I think you are in the presence of people who feel like you about the undesirability of doing things just because you're told to do them without any further elucidation than that. But I think in terms of the funding, then the answer around the timing is we're not entirely sure.
Well, the Welsh Government budget will be, I think that will be issued and decided around December. And we will then, when the Commission is launched, we'll be inheriting those decisions that are actually made by government. Moving into the following year, there will still be decisions made around the budget because it will be Welsh Government that will decide on that budget. But I think there will be more options then for the Commission to decide how is that money spent. Whether it's a hypothecated budget or hypothecate, and to the extent in which it is, we don't know yet.
So a bit of watch this space there for Edward. If we go back to the school-led question then, because this has obviously been a debate in Wales and a model for school improvement, really, that a lot of people in the room have been engaged in for quite a considerable period. What are your views, if we could start with Owen, on how school-led should our system be?
Okay, cool. I think, you know, before we start, you can never get away from the expertise of people who are doing the job day in, day out. So I'd say that right from the start. But I think, you know, there's a couple of principles that we need to adhere to. The first is that wherever the responsibility and the accountability sits, that's clear, because sometimes I think it isn't. And I think, you know, that the curriculum, in a phrase, is something that's handed over a huge amount of accountability and responsibility back to the profession, which I'd certainly welcome. But I don't think you can ignore the fact that in certain circumstances, because of efficiencies or economies of scale, that some aspects were probably better off being led on a national basis. So I think it's a balance. I think there are some things clearly the practitioners should be leading on. But I think just in the interest of efficiency, and, you know, we know the burden on the profession at the moment is quite high, that having a continuity across how we're doing things sometimes might help. But it's got to be done in a way that doesn't take that responsibility and that flexibility away from the profession.
I think we're probably in subsidiarity territory, somewhere along this line. But asking Helen, as a director for education for a local authority, how school-led do you think a system should be?
Thanks, Anna. It's an interesting question. And I would say, you know, intuitively, you'd think that autonomy is a good thing, and people being allowed to just conduct their business in an unfettered way is a good thing as well. But it doesn't always play out that way. History will tell us that not having checks and balances in the system can sometimes lead to disaster. So very much in the same camp as Owen, really, in terms of being this being quite a balanced viewpoint. Take, for example, the role of the local authority. At last count, I had 20 pages of statutory functions that I need to fulfil as a director of education. That amounts to about 100 pieces of legislation. Now, I could pass that on to a lot of my schools in Swansea. I don't think they'd thank me for it. So, you know, there could be a lot less interference if they took on the roles that the local authority has to undertake, and indeed some of the consortia across Wales. But I think, in summary, I would say that there needs to be a respect and recognition and acknowledgement, really, of our respective roles. We've spoken about the middle tier this morning. I think the clear delineation of function and roles and responsibilities, they need to be potentially shrunk as well, as our resources are shrinking. I think we need to look in a very shrinkable way at how things are looking across Wales. And we've talked very often about having a crowded landscape in terms of education. The whole system has a crowded football pitch, and we're all trying to aim for the same goals, designing fantastic destinations for our learners, but we are being interfered from all directions. So I think there's space for us to consider how we slim things down in Wales.
Diolch yn fawr, Helen. Emyr, this might be a question for you in your present guise and in your future guise, potentially.
I'll attempt the first one then, first. So I think giving it a perspective, I suppose, from the Qualifications Wales point of view, you know, how schools-led should the system be? Well, it's clear, as others have said, that schools have an incredibly important voice and need to have that really loud voice, I think, in shaping policy and in shaping decisions that affect what happens within schools. And I think when we are talking about qualifications, we are particularly interested in trying to ensure that we are guided by this principle that schools are best placed to decide what's right for their individual learners. And we need to take that very much into account when we're thinking about which qualifications need to be available and how those qualifications are then developed and assessed. So absolutely, I think schools have an important voice, but then we have to remember that within schools there are different voices that we need to take account of. There is the very important voice of the leadership, of teachers, of governors, of learners, and there are others in the system beside that have a stake in qualifications. And I think it was mentioned earlier about people having accountability for the right things and playing their part. And when we look at qualifications, it's very important that they work on the ground, that they give schools the tools they need to organise their offer to learners, that they're deliverable. But it's under the day, it's the learners who take and gain those qualifications, and they need those qualifications to function as a currency for them when they want to move on to the next thing. And we saw that very starkly during the pandemic in terms of the important function that qualifications have, not only in influencing what happens in schools, but also the role, the vital role that they play for learners in terms of helping them to move forward and to progress. And so we also have to balance other voices that have a stake in those qualifications that learners gain in terms of the learners themselves, but also the, what we call the users of qualifications, those who rely on those qualifications results to tell them something about a prospective learner or an applicant for a job, etc. So it's it is, I guess my focus is more on it's a system. We all have voices and parts to, you know, voices to be heard and parts to play in that system.
Lovely. Diolch yn fawr. I think it's interesting, isn't it? Because Owen started with the point of needing clarity around how that system works and who's responsible for what. And then we populated it with a lot of different bodies and lots of different requirements. So perhaps the question to return to is what it actually means.
One point perhaps to make is that one of the things we want to try and secure is that qualifications have a very clear purpose, and they will have different purposes. But so often when people hear us talk about qualifications, what our experience is that people will tend to think about school accountability and school performance measures. And one of the things that's quite encouraging and hopeful, I think, about this latest reform journey is how often it's been discussed that we need, as far as possible, to find better ways of telling us something about how good our education system and how well our education system is performing, that doesn't place such a high reliance on those qualification outcomes that ultimately are for the learners taking them primarily, and not to get those distortions that can happen, I think, when those results are then used for many other purposes that create all sorts of difficulties across the system.
I agree, Amelia, because I think that when we think about defining what school-led is and we think about being in school or a particular school and what that school is, the superpower is the learners and the community and their voices. So I think that we need to use the voice very much within that, striking the balance, as well as all of the other aspects that we consider.
Lovely, dear. I've got two questions here that I would like to ask. People have submitted them, one on the PDG. But to start first with Owen, and it's a lengthy question, but I will read it out because I think it's important to get the context. During a consultation into Eston's inspection arrangements back in 2019, a main message from respondents was the need to prioritise well-being and mental health. Does Eston recognise that when 2/3 of inspections have recommendations linked to the quality of teaching, that this may have a negative impact on the mental health of teachers within these schools, as well as contributing to a recruitment crisis? Would your response be to that, that it feels for some people maybe a little out of kilter?
I think you can't get it, you know, whenever I talk about up here, you can't get away from the fact that an Eston inspection is going to involve stress. You know, I think whatever we say about not preparing and, you know, actually working with us to identify the areas the school needs to improve, as well as the bits that we actually want to shout out about, you're all proud people, you run proud institutions, you run proud teams, so you're going to want you to do your best. So we take it very seriously. And a number of the conversations we've had over the past few years have been looking at how we de-stress the interaction between ourselves and yourselves, both during the inspection itself, but particularly beforehand, to try and get the point across is that, yes, we'll be looking for what you do really well, and we'll be telling people about it, but we're all in this together. Every organisation here is always striving to find out what are the bits that we could actually do better at. And that's what the approach that we've taken, for example, in not focusing on individual teachers within an inspection, to one now where we talk about the education that children are getting as a whole, I think is a very positive one. It takes away that spotlight from the individual. The fact that we've introduced the nominee model, that there's quite a lot of work before we actually arrive with the school about understanding the particular circumstances of that school, because every school is different. Through to the fact that, you know, we're really trying to ramp up the interaction we have with peer inspectors. So when we go in, you know, it's not just us telling. We've got people who are at the coalface week in, week out as part of what we're doing. Now, those are systemic things we've done. We've done things that are additional to that as well, particularly looking at the senior leadership. Things like, you know, I've been on countless inspections now, and I go out every fortnight and I have a cup of tea with the head, as I said. And every single day, you know, and if you don't have this, you must tell me, there is always the question, are you okay? And that's to the head, but it's also to the staff of that school. Do we need to know anything about that? And we've had countless episodes where a teacher, because of the stress or whatever, has not felt able. And we've changed the inspection based on that information. So I think we're supportive. And I think that the last gap, really, or the step in this, is that, you know, you guys have got a, you know, leadership is a lonely place. We realise the burden that this actually places on you. So we have recently actually signed a new protocol with ADU about how we notify local authorities where we think the senior leaders are under are suffering and their well-being is a cause of concern. So I think we're never perfect, and we're always looking at ways of de-stressing it. But we've done an awful lot, really, in trying to take the personal focus out and to reinforce the fact that we're all looking at the same thing, which is, how do we get better?
Diolch yn fawr. I'll ask one question of Helen, if I may, and then if there is one final one from the floor, we'd be happy to take that as well. This is from Claire Armistead in Rhyl High School. I don't know if Claire is here. I'm taking my glasses off again. Possibly not. PDG, she says, has in the past mitigated for the impact of poverty. As the pandemic disproportionately impacted our most vulnerable learners, how can we address this impact with reducing financial support? And that's all of a piece, I suppose, with the budget comments that we've had regularly throughout the day. What would you say specifically in relation to PDG and the pandemic?
That's a really difficult question. Obviously, PDG does not go as far as it does. I mean, it's flatlined in terms of its value, so £1,150. When you aggregate that up, it probably pays for staff in some schools. In some leafy suburb schools, it doesn't really touch the sides with anything. But it's been used historically to prop the budget up in many primary schools, and latterly, I would argue, in secondary schools as well. So I think, given the cost of living crisis, the economic crisis, that we have to look differently at using the resources we do have. We can't use the same, albeit shrunk resources, to fulfil the same kind of duties or needs or meet the needs of learners. So I think we have to pause, as I said earlier, and reflect about innovative ways of doing things. We just simply can't continue doing the things we used to do post-pandemic. And unfortunately, the resource is not going to grow. So it's a question of how can we do the best with the resources we've got, and what will be the biggest yield, really, in terms of meeting the needs of those vulnerable learners. So at a local authority level, obviously, you know, on a bigger scale than a school level, but definitely at a local authority level, we've had to repurpose our resources and reprioritise our resources to meet these new and growing needs, and maybe take our foot off the pedal in some other areas and focus our energy where we see the prevailing wind, so to speak, or the prevailing need. So I think it's a question of reprioritising and being very, very creative with the funding that you've got to meet the current need.
Diolch yn fawr, Helen. Is there one final question? Oh, oes. Yn fan hyn, Matthew. Diolch.
Yeah, diolch, Helen.
Thank you, Helen. Following on from what you said there, and I agree with you 100%, that middle tier, that there are many people, a large number of people in that middle tier, but how radical do you think we should be as a nation to ensure that there's far more clarity in terms of the middle tier, so that there's clarity between government and schools, and maybe to reduce the voices needed, if that's what you're saying. In terms of a radical solution, if I was in any type of situation to do something about it, I would look at the roles and responsibilities and the legislation that we have to ensure that everything is contemporary, up to date, and that the roles suitable for the 21st century. Some of the responsibilities in schools, for example, belong to another century, and that's true across the various tiers in education. A number of organisations clearly look into the future, but certainly there's room for us to look with a fresh pair of eyes at what is contemporary, what is necessary within the funding that we have as a nation. Thank you very much, Matthew. Thank you very much, Helen. And I think with that, and to note that this is the type of thing that has come up consistently today, is the importance of collaboration, discovering solutions, creative solutions, being radical, somewhere between Helen and Matthew, probably. But that, as the requirements become wider, and the ability in some areas to fund those is shrinking, then we need to find that creativity and the willingness to collaborate, and that's going to be even more important than it has been in the past. And maybe being radical isn't something to be feared either. And with that,
we can bring today's proceedings to a close, and to thank you very much for travelling. Some of you I know very long distances. I've heard descriptions of long journeys through the dark in the morning, in the dinner queue. Felly diolch yn fawr iawn I chi.
So thank you very much for your contributions and your questions, and hopefully we can do something like this again in the near future. Thank you very much, and a safe journey home. And thanks to the panelists as well.